because the more you ask questions, the better the more suitable the lecture will be for you, as opposed to a lecture by me for me. All right, now, as I said to you before, the natural and simple way to think about curved space is to imagine, or curved space-time, is to imagine that it's inside some bigger space-time that's flat. And you can always do that. You can always, as long as the space-time is, you know, non-pathological, in other words, smooth, you can always say that, well, it's embedded in some bigger space-time that is flat. Now, there is one subtlety here, and this, I must say, that this is a, this is something that I find just a little bit mysterious, because once you put your curved space-time in some larger R8 or R4 or R9 or whatever flat space, you still have to decide, well, what's the metric in that flat space? And typically what you do is you choose a metric that's either all plus or minus one. But the curious thing is that in general you may need a minus sign. Or normally you only need one minus sign, but it's and or zero. But what I find just a little bit puzzling, or at least mysterious. I mean, I see it mathematically, but I find it physically curious that the way these minus signs come about.
When we're talking about metrics, is that a norm by a different name?
Well, the basic idea is in a product. So in other words, you have two vectors. If you're in the ordinary three-dimensional space that is locally flat, we just use the dot product and add them together, right? And so the question is, how does the dot product change in these spaces? And in the embedding space, sometimes the dot product has a minus sign in it.
There's a lot of different inner products to choose from.
Yeah, but we're choosing the simplest ones.
But, you know, like, regardless of what R8, R9, we're still sticking with you put in one?
No, well, we're basically, in my experience, you can either have a Euclidean dot product in, say, R8 or R7 or whatever it is, or you need maybe one minus sign. And sorry, so let me go on with this just a bit here. Suppose we change the coordinates of the point a little bit. How does the point change? Well, the point changes, obviously, is the derivative of the point with respect to, let us say, xi dxi. So that's how the point changes. But these points have coordinates in the embedding space. I'm going to call those coordinates alpha. I try to avoid Greek and Latin, but occasionally, just to distinguish it from the eyes, it's that. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to call these things e alpha I of x dx I. So these are the basis vectors. And we talked about these basis vectors last week and on Tuesday. And now, it turns out that the metric of whatever the space of space-time is turns out to be the dot product of two basis vectors. But then the question is, well, what is this dot product? And so it's a sum over alpha of EI alpha of X and some internal metric that's basically I alpha beta E beta J of X. But now, as I said to you, in my experience, this I alpha beta is always sigma alpha delta alpha beta. So this is really a sum over where sigma alpha beta, sigma alpha is plus or minus one. And so this is a sum sigma alpha E alpha I of X, and this should be a K. E alpha K of X. So this is then the formula in every case I know of what the metric of the space, the space time is. And it's these sigmas are normally positive, but in some cases there's an occasional minus sign. And I'm going to give you some examples of this. You know, I just printed out a new version of this. Let me grab it from the printer. I forgot to get it. Let me also mention something. There's a colloquium, of course, tomorrow. You should go to all the colloquia. I think tomorrow's going to be particularly good. I heard the guy speak today, and he communicates very well. So it's 3:30 up the hill. Unfortunately, it's a room that chairman likes to shut both doors, and then there's almost no ventilation. So we share each other's viruses, and if anybody has a flu, we're all dead.
Do you know what it's on?
Excuse me?
Do you know what it's on?
It's thermodynamics.
Yeah, okay. It's on. It's sort of on Brownian motion. You know how. You know, if you have a gas or a liquid, the molecules are bouncing around like crazy. In fact, the number of times per second that a molecule hits another molecule is something like 10 to the 20th. It's crazily large. And not that they're going that fast, but they're also close together. And there are questions having to do with entropy and Brownian motion, and Maxwell actually was thinking about these things, and he introduced something called the Maxwell demon. And the idea would be that if, you know, that this demon might be able to open and shut a door and let the hot molecules, the cold molecules, let those cold molecules go into the cold side and the hot ones go into the hot side, and you'd be refrigerating one side and heating up the other side, and that's, you know, totally different from what happens in ordinary thermodynamics. And so this guy's going to be talking about things like that. Anyway, he's a good guy. His name is Raisin or something. And the room, if we put it in this curved space-time, it's room 125 of Dane Smith Hall. And so that's where I recommend you go. Just don't breathe while you're there because you're going to get sick. Also, the air is so damn stuffy, and you don't want to breathe. Okay, so this is the metric then of space-time. It's a GIK, in other words, is GI dot EK. It's just a dot product of two basis vectors. The basis vectors, in turn, are just the derivatives of the physical points with respect to the coordinates. And the inner product is whatever the inner product is in the space. All right, now I want to give you some examples of this. And the first example is the sphere. And so the surface of the sphere, this is our favorite example. By the way, I'm going to do a demo next Tuesday of the equivalence principle. And this is a fun demo that our machine shop made. It's not original with me, but it's a fun demo. Anyway, it was actually originated by a friend of Einstein's who made it for Einstein for his last birthday, I think. And Einstein was delighted with it. So this is a copy of that. Okay, so what we have then on the sphere is we have these theta going this way and p going that way. And so what we have is a point on the sphere that has radius r. It's sine theta cosine phi sine theta sine phi cosine theta, right? Let me just make sure I have this. Okay. So this is what I call P the physical point because it's a point on the surface, the curved surface. Now it's embedded just in ordinary free space. So now we can define, which one did I do first? E theta. So this is partial of P with respect to theta. And what will that be? Well, that will be R. This would be cosine theta, cosine phi, cosine theta, sine phi, and then this is minus sine theta. And then we can say, what is E phi? Well, E phi is partial p partial phi. So I'm just using this equation here. Hello? This equation. And if we do that, then we have R minus sine theta sine phi sine theta cosine phi and then zero. So these are the two vectors. And these vectors, you see, what do they look like? Well, on the surface of the sphere, if we look at the edge of the sphere there, at a given point, E theta looks like that. It points out that way. And E phi is pointing into the board at that point. Anyway, these are the two vectors. And now you can notice that E theta dot E theta, well, as I said, this is embedded in ordinary R3, so the dot product is just the ordinary dot product. And what is that? Well, that will be R squared, and it will be cosine squared theta, cosine squared phi, plus cos squared theta sine squared phi plus sine squared phi theta. And now you see cosine
squared plus sine squared, that's 1. So then we have cosine squared plus sine squared, and so this thing is just r squared. We do the same thing for e phi with dotted into e phi. What we get is r squared, and then we have sine squared theta times sine squared phi plus sine squared theta cosine squared phi. So all together this is sine squared theta. Okay, so that's the dot product of e phi with e phi. And the dot product of e theta with e phi is just 0. As you can see, this thing gives you cosine, sine, cosine, sine. And this is also cosine, sine, and there's a minus sign here. Anyway, 0. So that gives us our metric, and the metric is, if we write the metric as g theta, g phi phi, and we know the other two components are 0, then this is r squared 1, 0, 0 sine squared theta. So this is the metric for the surface of a sphere in a three-dimensional space, and the coordinates theta and phi are the coordinates on the the polar coordinates on the sphere. And what's invariant here? Well, the p's are invariant, and in particular, the difference between p plus dp. Well, it's just dp squared, let us say. Because dp squared is invariant. And what is dp squared? Well, dp squared is just ei dxi dotted into ek dxk. And so this is gik dxi dxk. So that's what invariant distance looks like in general. And if we come over here, we would say it's often written as ds squared rather than dp squared. So we'd say ds squared is r squared, and this thing is d theta squared plus r squared sine squared theta dp squared. And so, in other words, that is g theta d theta squared plus g phi phi d phi squared. Okay, so that's the sphere. And now, written this way, it's perfectly transparent. We can make a change of variables that will make it mysterious. And in fact, that's what's actually done in cosmology. So let me do it for you in the case where it's very simple. And what we're going to do is we're going to have a new parameter called A. And this is going to be dimensionless. This is just a number. And we call it the scale factor. So this is the thing that plays such an important role in cosmology, the scale factor. And then we're going to introduce a radial variable r, which is going to be capital R, which is the radius of the sphere, times sine theta divided by this dimensionless scale factor. And then we're going to introduce a parameter k, which is going to be a squared over r squared. Well, R squared, let's see, R is that, and so, where's my little eraser? It's sort of easier to go from the other side. So let me just say, dr, of course, is r over a cosine theta d theta. And so we can say that r squared d theta squared, which is the first term here in ds squared, r squared d theta squared will be a squared dr squared divided by cosine squared theta. On the other hand, cosine squared theta, of course, is 1 minus sine squared theta. And sine theta is AR over big R. And so this is 1 minus A squared R squared over big R squared. And this thing is K, so this is 1 minus K R squared. So now we've turned it into a completely mysterious form. And in fact, the other term, R squared sine squared theta d phi squared, well, R sine theta is just RA. And so the quantity R squared sine squared theta d phi squared is just from that a squared r squared a squared r squared d phi squared. So altogether, the new metric is this. The distance is a squared dr squared over 1 minus k r squared plus a squared r squared d phi squared. And so the new metric g, in these new variables, it's the same metric, is a squared 1 over 1 minus kr squared 0, 0 r squared. So that's a way of rewriting the metric of an ordinary sphere in three space, and it's rewritten in a way that makes it look a lot like the metric of cosmology, which we'll get to. But I just wanted to show you. All right, I see some puzzle expressions. Notice if, okay, so this is, all right, look, I see all these browns. Let's ask a question or say something so that I can know how to respond.
More of an opinion, more than a question.
All right, what's your question?
Are you getting at the Friedman?
What?
Are you getting at?
Yeah. Okay. We're gonna get like the famous metrics of general relativity or of cosmology. But before we get to them, I just wanted to show you what they look like in the simple context of a sphere.
What is the significance of G again?
Of what?
G.
Well, G is the metric. And it's a great question. Here, let me throw this candy to you.
Okay.
Good catch. All right. So the thing is, suppose we change coordinates by a little bit.
on the curved surface, or on the curved surface that may be space or space-time. Then the question is, what is the distance there? And well, the distance there is defined as the dot product of that vector with itself. And what is that vector? Well, that vector is the change in the point, and so that is the derivative of the point with respect to distance, the vector coordinates, and that's a basis vector times the coordinate thing. But then to find out not what it is as a vector, but what it is as a distance, we dot it into itself using the metric of the embedding space. And when we do that, what we get is dp squared is ei dot ek dxi dxk. And that is gij dxi dxk. And so gij is said to be the metric of the space. And so that tells you what the distance is in terms of changes of coordinates. In general, it's not diagonal, but it often is. And it's almost always symmetric. Some hardcore relativists object to that last statement. Okay. All right, now, having given you the... All right, maybe I was... I think I ought to do these in... All right. This was S2, which is just an ordinary sphere in three space. So now what I'm going to show you is a hyperboloid. And this is also going to be in three space, but we're going to make one of the space things a time coordinate. So we're going to say the internal metric, instead of being plus, plus, plus for ordinary three space, it's going to be plus, plus, minus. So I'll show you what this is. I'm running out of board space. What is the hyperbola? Well, of course, what I should have done over here was to say that the coordinates here are such that r squared is x squared plus y squared plus z squared. That's the surface of the sphere of radius r. Here we've got something different. And we're talking about this hyperboloid, which is called H2 in R3. And it is defined by r squared equals x squared plus y squared minus z squared. And so what you see is we've got an internal metric here. This internal metric now is going to be 1, 1, minus 1. So it's 1 minus sign. Okay, what are the points? We want x, y, and z to satisfy this equation. And so we set the thing to the point P to be R. And I'm going to use a Russian abbreviation. I'm going to call Sinch, S-H, and Kosh, C-H. The reason the Russians do this is that it's very natural for the Russians. They can even do me one better here. Because they have a special letter for SH and another special letter for CH. So they just have two different letters. All right, so this is going to be SH of theta cosine phi, SH of theta sine phi, and then CH of theta. Okay, well, so this is x, this is y, this is z, and what you can see is that x squared plus y squared minus z squared is r squared, and if we're going to check that, all right, let's check it. R squared, what is it? It's r squared, x squared is going to be sh squared, cos squared, plus sh squared, sine squared, and then minus cosh squared. Well, of course, this plus this just gives us sinh squared. So this is r squared times sin squared minus cos squared. And I think I've screwed up the sign. I'm getting minus, right? In other words, this is minus r squared.
On the point, or I guess, never mind. wouldn't the last coordinate be a negative ch theta?
Yeah, it is. That's how I got from there to there.
Okay.
So I think what I should have done, so let's rescue this on the fly. What I should have done was make this CH, SH. And then this would have been CH squared minus SH squared. This would be CH squared minus SH squared, and this would be plus R squared. Okay, so now I've done it. I fixed a mistake. So now we can compute. So in other words, this point P, let me rewrite this point P, it's R CH theta cos phi, CH theta sine phi, SH theta. And now if we differentiate, we get E theta is the derivative with respect to theta, and this gives us R SH of theta cos phi, SH of theta sine phi, and then CH of theta,
right, there's no minus sign when we differentiate.
And then E phi is going to be R CH theta or minus CH theta sine phi CH theta cos phi and then zero. And then the dot product of these two you can verify is zero. So E theta, the dot product differs from the dot product of ordinary Euclidean space just by the minus sign at the end, but the product is zero anyway, so it doesn't matter. So E theta dot E phi is zero. E theta dot E theta will be R squared, and now it's going to be CH squared cos squared plus sine squared, so that's just SH squared, and then minus CH squared, and that is minus R squared. So I've got this pesky minus sign again, and then E phi dot E phi is just R CH squared of theta.
Where the square is on.
Yes,
did I screw something up?
Is the R squared in the last one? In the E5?
Oh. Yes, that's for sure. Okay, so
he gets that one.
All right, I think I should straighten out the line of signs here. One way of dealing with it is to say that we need two minus signs in this space, but I don't think we need two minus signs. All right, so I'm going to have to redo this hyperboloid. What puzzles me here is that I'm surprised that I've got E theta squared actually negative.
Sorry, So for dot products in this space, you just subtract the last term when you are adding them together.
You mean how do the, okay, we
you
assume
said the
that
dot
this
products
is right. E theta dot E theta, we use this, the metric that's 1, 1, minus 1.
Yeah.
So
okay.
It's this squared plus that squared minus
yeah,
this
okay.
squared.
Yeah, that's what I
and that gave me this this case here, and it's all right, I'm going to have to think about it to see what the definition is. All right, let's fearlessly go on to three-dimensional surfaces embedded in four-space. And one case is just the sphere S3. And so these are points R squared equals X squared plus Y squared plus Z squared plus W squared. So the metric here is just plus 1, plus 1. The internal metric, the metric of the embedding space is plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, plus 1. So I have no minus sign issues. The point P, and if we use all of these crazy Greek letters, it looks like this. R, and then sine P, sine theta, cos phi sine phi sine theta sine phi, and then the third one is sine phi cosine theta and then cosine phi. Okay, if that's our P, and if I haven't made any mistakes, then the basis vector E key, partial P, partial Q, is R, and this is cosine P, sine theta, cosine P, sine theta, sine P, cosine theta, minus sine P. Okay, this is exhausting. I put the web the notes, the chapter on the web page, so maybe I shouldn't try to write everything down. Anyway, E theta, you just do the same thing, partial P, partial theta, and E phi is partial P, partial phi, and you get these various vectors. You then say, well, ds squared then, first of all, they're all orthogonal to each other. And so ds squared is ep dot ep dt squared plus e theta dot e theta d theta squared plus e phi dot e phi d phi squared. And let me just say that if you do the usual thing, which I just sketch for the case of the sphere, in the two spheres, the three sphere, we set k, a parameter k equal to a dimensionless scale factor divided by r squared, and then we set r equal to r sine p divided by a, or maybe we just set ar equal to r sine p. After you make all those substitutions, what you find is that ds squared is equal to a squared times dr squared over 1 minus kr squared plus r squared d theta squared plus R squared sine squared theta dB squared. Okay, and this in fact is the, this is the, actually the Robinson-Walker metric for a closed, well, for the space part of a closed space-time. That is to say, I'm setting dx0 equal to 0, so I'm not including dx0. Now, I've also got the hyperboloid H3, but inasmuch as I ran into a sign issue with the hyperboloid H2, I hesitate to go through this in detail. So I think I'll just tell you, if you choose signs correctly, what you get is that ds squared is a squared dr squared over 1 plus kr squared plus r squared d theta squared plus r squared sine squared theta dp squared. So this is the open ds squared for dx0 equals 0, so no time change. This is just the space part. So in other words, to put it differently, we have two, apart from the totally flat cosmological model, which, by the way, is pretty reliable. But for the two curved ones, space then, physical space, three-dimensional physical space, no change in time, is of this distances in space, ds squared, if you change the coordinates, dr squared, d theta squared, dv squared, it's the same as moving on the surface of a sphere embedded in four-dimensional Euclidean space. So in other words, our three-dimensional space-time is really, in this picture, is really the surface of a sphere, the three-dimensional surface of a sphere in Euclidean four space. And in fact, there was some poet, famous poet, long ago said something, it might have been E. Cummings, I don't know. Was it?
I don't know.
All right, anyway.
I know who that is, so I'm thinking about it. I know who that is.
All right, anyway, what he was saying was that if you could look out and see far enough, what you'd see would be the back of your head.
Just close its face.
And, okay, that's that picture. The other picture for the open universe is quite different. It's that our physical free space is the surface of a hyperboloid, and the hyperboloid is something that has one minus sign in the interim. So it's a four-dimensional space, but the inner product in that four-dimensional space has one minus sign. So it's as if we're living in our three-dimensional space is the surface of something that has three space and one time coordinates. Three space coordinates and one time coordinate. All right. I'll fix the minus sign mistake and put the corrected version on the class webpage. Let's see, maybe there are some questions apart from how do you fix the minus sign. All right. Let me give you the physical, the principle of equivalence in
in physical terms. Okay, so suppose you're in a high-rise building with an elevator. They're really fast elevators. Well, when I was last on sabbatical, I actually had an office on the, I don't remember now whether it was the 26th floor or the 36th floor, what it was, but it was at least 26th floor. And in fact, one of the really crazy things was how they washed the windows on the outside. These poor guys were just hanging on ropes, swinging like monkeys. And they were 26 floors above the ground. And they must have had girders of steel. I mean, you know, when it's done in the States, you've got some elaborate platform that's, I wouldn't get on that either, but that's really supported. But these guys, I think, were just on ropes from the roof, which was 30 stories high. If I can find a picture, I may put a picture of one of them on the classroom page. Anyway, they had really fast elevators in this building, and so you remember getting on the elevator, and at first, the elevator would accelerate downward until it got to a fixed speed going downward. And when it accelerated downward, I felt really light. And then when it went to a fixed speed, I had my normal weight again. And the sensation I had psychologically was that once I gained my normal weight, or recovered my normal weight, I assumed the elevator was stopping at a floor, and so I started cursing the person who pressed that button. but instead, it was just that the elevator had gone to a constant downward speed. Now, if one of the cables had broken in the elevator, then, of course, we all would have been weightless temporarily in the elevator, and the funny thing is that if you drop, say, your cell phone, it falls to the ground, but if you're in the elevator that's falling, you drop your cell phone, it doesn't fall to the ground. And that's called a free fall coordinate system, an elevator that's broken. Let me say something about that mathematically. I guess I'll go back to this part of the board because there is some black space here. So we have this metric of space-time, and it's symmetric and it's real. And the reason it's symmetric is that the physical thing is just, well, all right, let's switch to K. It's that the physical distance, ds squared, is gik dxi dxk. So this is the thing that's physical, so only the symmetric part of this matters. Because an anti-symmetric part, if this is any anti-symmetric part of this, when multiplied by dxi, dxk, and then summed over I and k, just vanishes. Okay, so this is real and symmetric, and in fact, what you can do is you can diagonalize it by an orthogonal transformation. And one way of writing that is GKL. OLJ is, and then we can diagonalize that, and then that is basically four real eigenvalues, E1, E2, E3, and, well, I call it E0, E1, E2, E3. And in fact, we can choose the orthogonal transformations of the feast things, so that this is just the flat space metric, minus 1, 1, 1, 1. And then, now, we can only do this at, we can do this at any point, but a given orthogonal transformation only works at one point. It's not going to work everywhere. And so what happens is we can say that in that that in the in other words, this ds squared is either dik dxi dxk, but it's also equal to eta ik d prime xi d prime xk locally, that is to say, near where we made this transformation. And these other coordinates, these prime coordinates, are the free fall coordinates. And the coordinate transformation is this, partial xk, partial x prime I is O transpose ik divided by square root of the absolute value of ei. Anyway, so that's the free fall coordinates. And so it's, as I said, the broken elevator coordinates. And the idea is that in fact, the principle of special relativity, I should rephrase it physically rather than just give you the elevator example. The idea is that you have an arbitrary gravitational field and pick any point, then in the vicinity of that point, you could make this transformation to free field coordinates, free fall coordinates, free fall coordinates. And in that reference frame, the equations of special relativity hold. So in other words, to take the broken elevator example again, in the coordinates of the coordinate frame of the falling elevator, there's no gravity, your cell phone still works, but it doesn't fall in that frame. But the electrodynamics of special relativity still makes the cell phone work. All right, now, another way of thinking about this, so I'm just going to say a word about this. This is just sort of a definition rather than an actual calculation. But as I said, in these free fall coordinates, what we have is that GIK is partial X prime A, partial XI, eta AB, partial X prime B, partial XK, and we can rewrite that as C I A of X, eta A B, C P K of X. So we can rewrite at any point, the space-time metric in terms of two vectors and the dot for this internal metrics. So in other words, one way of thinking about it, this eta AB, which is the
flat space metric that we talked about when we talked about special relativity. This is kind of playing the role of this internal metric. Anyway, these things are called the moving frame, and in fact, this is just partial x prime a, partial x I. And so, and the person who emphasized these was Cartan, and actually I spelled his name wrong. It's an A there. And these are called a moving frame, a tetrad, and the Germans would call them a vierbein. Okay, now let me switch to something else quickly. We have this symmetric real tensor. We can define its inverse, and the inverse would be GIK, say GKL is delta IL. So this is covariant. This is contravariant, and we also could take the basis vectors and make dual basis vectors by using this inverse metric. So sum over k of the inverse metric gives you the dual vector, and what the dual vector does is that EI dot EL, say, well, this would be GIK EK dot EL, but this is GIK, and this is just GKL. And now, since this is the inverse of that, this is just delta IL. So these dual vectors, which are obtained by multiplying by the inverse of the G metric, of the G matrix, gives you vectors that are orthogonal to the basis vectors. These are called dual vectors. And in fact, then, in general relativity, all raising and lowering of indices is done with either you lower an index with G and you raise it with G inverse. So in general, AL is GLK, AK, and AK is G, KI, AI. So this G raises and lowers all indices. Okay, now there are some sections here that I'm basically going to skip because it's kind of, it's a little bit dull, but maybe I should do, let me do a little bit of it, namely this business of basis vectors is perhaps well, maybe not. No, I'm just going to skip. Okay, let's think about a gradient. If f is a scale, f of x, say, is a scale field, then what's df? Well, df, of course, is f of x plus dx minus f of x. That's what I mean by df. And what would that be? Well, it's obviously partial f, partial xi, dxi. And we often will write this as df dot dx. And so, df is ei partial f partial xi. I meant to make this dp. And because now, if we say dp, we say this is that, then we have EI partial F partial XI. And now DP is EK DXK. These guys are orthogonal to each other, and so this is partial F partial XI DXI. So in other words, this is an invariant way of writing the gradient. Because since this is a sum over I, one contravariant, one covariant, this is coordinate independent. And that's a nice way to think about the gradient. All right, there's a section here on the Levi-Civitas symbol. This section is more technical than I like. So let me just say a couple of things, and I'll skip all the proof and derivation part and just define a couple of things. First of all, in three space, we have epsilon ijk, and this is the same thing as epsilon ijk raised, and it's called the Levi-Civitas symbol. So this isn't a tensor, this is just a symbol. And it's plus or minus one, totally anti-symmetric, and epsilon 1, 2, 3 is one. Okay. Now, you can make a tensor, though, this way. A rank 3 covariant tensor, you write it as square root of g times epsilon ijk. So this is just the symbol. Now what's g? G is just the absolute value of the determinant of g of gik, the ordinary, the metric of space-time, not the inverse of the metric. And some people don't have the absolute value, then they have to put a minus sign because determinant of g is negative because there's one I minus sign and three plus signs. One can also define this, do this Levi-Civitas stuff in four dimensions. And in that case, it's the same business, basically. You've got a symbol that's then epsilon ijkl, and it's the same thing as epsilon ijkl. And then you define what is, by the way, this is actually a pseudo-tensor. It's a pseudo-tensor in the sense that with an ordinary tensor, if you flip, say, the space components, you get, if you had, suppose ijk were all space, and you flipped all of them, you get a minus sign. Well, it turns out you don't get a minus sign in this case. So that's why it's called a pseudo-tensor. Anyway, if you define eta as square root of g times, say, ijkl, epsilon ijkl, then this is a four-dimensional pseudo-tensor. All right, that's all I'm going to say about that. You can do cute things with it, but I think it's overly technical. Yeah, what?
I don't need any candy. I'm sorry to bother you. I thought that Levi-Civitas symbol was only defined for three subscripts. Where's the fourth? What's the meaning of the L now?
Well, I mean, you could have 0, 1, 2, 3. So this thing is totally anti-symmetric, and epsilon 0, 1, 2, 3 is plus 1.
2, 1, 3 is negative, but then...
0, 1, 2, 3 is plus 1. That's the way I'm defining it. All right, let's... Yeah. Okay, we have a little bit of time left. I'm going to tell you now something that is, I mean, so far, we've had various concepts, and now there's going to be something really new and sort of important, because it goes, remember when I said to you that in connection with Yang Mills theories that it was easy to make a theory that was invariant under a symmetry transformation that was the same at every point in space-time. But you needed a trick that Yang Mills discovered to do it in general if the symmetry transformation varied with the point in space-time. And so we're going to be touching on that now. And so let me think first of all about something that's invariant. So this is going to be a contravariant vector, and then I'm going to be multiplying it by these basis vectors. So this is a scalar. But if we differentiate the scalar, we're going to get something that is a covariant vector, but this covariant vector has a bit of a problem. And the problem is one that you can even see on the sphere in the sphere S2 and 3 space. If you differentiate E theta with respect to theta, well, what happens? One E theta is there, but if you go here, E theta is pointing that way. And so the derivative of this E theta is actually a vector that points perpendicular to the surface, points toward the center of the sphere. And so that means that the derivative of these basis vectors, you see, if we're talking about geometry on the surface of the sphere, we sort of want to stay in the surface of the sphere. And the awkward thing is that when you differentiate these basis vectors, you get something that isn't a linear combination of the basis vectors. Do you need a candy to stay awake?
No, I'm sorry.
We're almost done. And so what we do is we do this. We take a dot product of this thing with a dual vector, like this. And so that gives us partial fi, partial xl, ek dot ei. Well, these guys are orthogonal. And then this is fi, ek dot partial ei, partial xl. And so this is partial fi, partial xl, delta ki, plus fi. Now, in general relativity, there's a special symbol for this. And the special symbol is a capital Greek gamma, il. And so this is partial FK, partial XL, K plus, and it's often written this way, IL FI. Well, you can put the FI in either place. So this thing is what's called the covariant derivative. So DL of FK is partial FK partial XL plus FI plus gamma K IL. So this is called the covariant derivative. And you remember that in the case of that the Yang-Mills trick was you replace the ordinary derivative with some new thing, a gauge field multiplying the thing you're differentiating. And so this gamma is playing the role of a gauge field. It's the analog of the gauge field. So I think we can stop now. Maybe there's a question.
You defined gamma sub IL upper K is partial of FK DXL.
No, not partial FK. No, it's the dual basis vector dotted into the derivative of a basis vector with respect to a coordinate. And this thing is called an affine connection. But those just words. In GR, there's some people write this as like this. I guess they'd write it this way. That's another way of writing it. But the trouble is that this is what I defined on the previous